Ralph Waldo Emerson, American philosopher and author, coined the phrase, "The first wealth is health." My name is Sara Bybee, and as an assistant professor in the College of Nursing, my research explores just that, the connection between health and wealth. When I was 19, I traveled to the Dominican Republic on a medical service trip with the goal of serving Haitian refugees. The families we helped lived in homes made out of plastic and tin. They had no sewer systems, no running water, and a complete lack of medical care. On the last day of our trip, we took the afternoon off to visit a beach, which happened to be next to a resort. I was confused. Here we were just mere miles from where we had been, managing these long lines of Haitian refugees seeking the most basic medical care. Yet at this private, all-inclusive resort, it seemed like resources abound. What struck me was the unfairness of it all. How can some people access and afford resources and medical care while others cannot? This experience and other experiences volunteering abroad inspired me to move from the suburbs of Chicago to Boston, where I double majored in Spanish and community health at Tufts University. With the goal of better understanding how healthcare disparities form and also how to help those who experience these healthcare disparities, I then earned my master's in social work at Portland State University. After graduation, serendipity landed me in this beautiful state of Utah, where I continued to be passionate about healthcare. As a licensed clinical social worker, I provided care to patients and families at Huntsman Cancer Hospital and at Primary Children's Hospital. About 5 years after working clinically, I decided that I wanted to be able to do more than help each patient on an individual level. I wanted to be able to prevent some of these negative psychosocial outcomes that I witnessed. The PhD program at the College of Nursing provided an opportunity to engage in transdisciplinary research with the goal of improving patient and family lives. During my doctoral studies, I was mentored by a team of transdisciplinary researchers from the fields of social work, nursing, and psychology, including my dissertation chair, Dr. Lee Ellington. While my dissertation research focused on the health outcomes among patients and spouses in the context of cancer, I really wanted to shift my research more upstream towards population health. Thus, I completed a postdoctoral fellowship at the Utah Clinical and Translational Science Institute, where I was fortunate enough to meet my current mentor, Dr. Andrea Wallace. Now, one of the most fundamental things that Dr. Wallace taught me was that up to 80% of a person's health is made up of non-medical factors. Medical factors are things like hereditary diseases, maybe the medications you take, whereas non-medical factors include environmental conditions like clean air, water, even housing, social and economic factors like your income, your education level, and also behaviors like diet and exercise. The fact that up to 80% of a person's health is made up of these factors gives me hope that by addressing these factors, we can greatly improve a person's health. For example, did you know that your zip code is a better predictor of your life expectancy than your genetic code? In some areas of the US, there's a 15-year difference in life expectancy in just a 5-mile radius. Here in Utah, as you can see on this map, where darker blue represents lower life expectancy, there's a difference of 9 years of life expectancy in a 6-mile radius between Rose Park on the west side of the valley and the East Bench, where you sit right now. Let me say that again. That's a difference of 9 years of life in 6 miles. In my research with Dr. Wallace on her National Institute of Health-funded study, we discovered that one of the most pressing unmet needs in Utah is related to housing instability, including difficulty paying rent or mortgage. We also know that trouble paying for housing causes stress and poor health. Now, given our findings and the connection with health, I developed a pilot study funded by the Emma Eccles-Jones Nursing Research Center. Let me tell you the who, what, why, and how of this study. What I really want to understand is who is experiencing housing instability in Utah. What type of housing instability? Why is this happening? And most importantly, how can we better address housing needs? My team and I are conducting 24 semi-structured interviews with low-income Utahns who previously reported difficulty paying their rent or mortgage or who had slept outside or in another place not typically meant for sleeping, such as a car. To date, we've interviewed 11 participants, each with a story more heartbreaking than the next. One participant, let's call her Maria, is a single mother to five children who rents her home on the west side of the valley near that Rose Park area that I just showed you. Now, the questions we asked Maria were really focused on her housing instability and also what kinds of community resources she sought to meet her needs. But what we uncovered was much more. Maria was being evicted by her landlord, but she owed 4 months' rent. This is a problem because Maria can't work. Among other things, she has been diagnosed with high cholesterol, depression, anxiety, panic disorder, and post-traumatic stress. Many of these mental health diagnoses were due to a lengthy history of abuse by her ex-husband, the reason she left him. Maria had been receiving Social Security income benefits, but her case was recently closed, leaving her with no way to support herself and her five children. I use this example to show how tightly woven health and wealth can be, and how often this relationship is cyclical in nature. While our study is still ongoing, our preliminary findings suggest that for low-income Utahns with difficulty paying housing, they often skimp on other necessities like groceries and medication in order to make monthly payments. We also found out that when individuals reach out for help from community resources, they receive little, if any, help, and their needs remain unmet. What this tells me is that we need to develop new programs and policies to better meet the needs of low-income Utahns with housing instability. Another study that my team is conducting is a National Institute on Aging funded R01. Now, the purpose of this study is to develop a survey that measures financial hardship for a wide array of persons living with dementia and their care partners. There are currently 7 million Americans living with Alzheimer's disease and related dementias. And by the year 2060, this number could reach as high as 14 million. Alzheimer's disease and related dementias are some of the costliest diseases in the world, with the majority of costs often shouldered by the person living with dementia and their care partner. When it comes to dementia, as the disease progresses, the person living with dementia often turns financial responsibilities over to their care partner. Now, the care partner, in turn, often pays for things like in-home care, medications, and maybe even groceries. So each person in this relationship can incur expenses related to ongoing care. Now, seeing as each person can incur expenses related to care, they can also both experience financial hardship, as well as the negative consequences of financial hardship, including worse mental and physical health. So the goal of our survey is to be able to assess financial well-being early on in the disease trajectory in order to prevent financial hardship and prevent the negative consequences associated with it. To conclude, I have had a wealth of mentors, collaborators, and funders who've helped me get to where I am today. Leading a $3.2 million research portfolio, supporting two fabulous full-time staff members, and mentoring doctoral and postdoctoral trainees. The College of Nursing has made me a better researcher, educator, mentor, but most importantly, a better human being. No one should have to suffer like the Haitian refugees I met in the Dominican Republic. When I think back about those flimsy homes made out of plastic and tin, I'm reminded that health isn't just about treating symptoms. It's about addressing the fundamental inequities that determines who thrives and who merely survives. Our work isn't just research. It's a roadmap for the future where your zip code no longer predicts your life expectancy and where each individual can write their own story of health and hope. Thank you for being here.